respect my rhymes, they are mine in my lines. Words of Christ, spirit and life. Take this mic, y'all never dim my light. I'm not hip-hop, I ain't gotta fake you. Since I'm not hip-hop, I won't let it shake me. I really don't agree, no hands will be shaking. I decline that pic, no photos will be taken. Gotta live out what I'm rhyming, no songs will be making. This is not Nathan and David, but Elijah versus Baal. I pick the spirit of demons, I am not loving the world, I'm not sale.
What's up, fellas?
What's up, Jerry, bro?
Man, good to see y'all, man. Just kind of wanted to come together, man, and actually talk about the project that we all participated in, which is titled Christian Rap. And we just wanted to just talk music, man, see where we all come from in terms of, you know, why we do music the way we do it. Honestly, it's exclusive. We don't really allow it to be tainted or tampered with as it relates to our processes or how we come up with production, our writing processes, our recording processes. We're very exclusive in how we do it and when we do it and where we do it. And I just kind of wanted us to touch on that. We definitely got Pastor G in the house with us again. Thank you, sir, for being here with us. So I'll just start by talking about the actual project. It taking as long as it took to, I wouldn't say, if everybody remember, this is Brian Johnson. I wouldn't say that it took a long time. It's just that when we decided to do it, it probably took around about, I don't know, 6 to 8 months after Pastor told it was whack like 3 times.
Yeah, he told us it was whack about 3 times. Yeah. It took about 6 to 8 months. But most of that time is us trying to figure each other out and trying to gel and, you know, figure where you was at and where I was.
Kind of get a consistent flow of, I guess, production style. And because we have full-time jobs, sometimes when, you know, everybody can speak to this as being creative. You, like, if I'm creative right now, we all start writing right now, and we work for the next couple of days. It's kind of hard to pick back up today, so that was kind of like what the issue was. And then in addition to that, you had to upgrade some of
Yeah, let me speak over that. So when Brian first started, BJ and Jermaine, and they, you know, they had a CD that they wanted me to hear. Once they had started and we had talked about it or whatever, he was like, okay, let me let you check it out. So I got the CD, and me and my son, Landon, sat down with it. And it was terrible. It was just terrible. The beats were whack, empty. The rapping sounded like he was trying to cover up the music because it was so whack. I mean, it was just whack. That's all I can say. That's our word here at ABC, whack.
Whack.
We're old school, so whack is just whack. That word will never change. Right. So this project was whack. So I was like, man, why does it sound so frigid and it just didn't sound like it lacked personality or it lacked feel or whatever. So I said, well, let me come over there, you know, and kind of check things out or whatever. And so I went to the studio, and immediately, as soon as I walked in the room, I knew what the problem was. First of all, Brian was using the, you remember the first Mac, 1984, you know, the box, the SE. It was similar to that, but he was running like Logic, like a version of Logic, but it just kept freezing. And he's like, man, this computer keep freezing. I said, Brian, that computer shouldn't even be running. And so it was an old computer. And then the way he was recording, or his work environment was all wrong, because he had that computer. And I think, was you looking up at the screen? Or what was it? Oh, no, you had, he didn't have a good chair.
Damn good chair.
He didn't have things set right, so he was basically uncomfortable. And what you gotta realize, even about production, that's gonna change the way your music comes out, because you're uncomfortable while you're producing it, so you're not gonna put the time in it to select good sounds, to, you know, you trying to rush because your back is hurting, your neck is hurting, and all of that. So I was like, Brian, first of all, you're gonna have to spend some money. And we all know Brian, everybody that knows how Brian is about money. And so if he gotta spend money, then we just not doing the album.
Right.
And so, but I told him, I was like, Brian, you're gonna have to spend some money. So he upgraded his Mac, got the latest version of Logic, got the monitor, set the monitor perpendicular to his body, because Brian's a big dude, he's tall. So he set everything up and got comfortable with it, you know, where he was. So then Jermaine like called me one day and was like, hey man, well, Jay Bryan, he said, hey man, Brian did this track, man, I want you to hear it. So after, you know, all of these changes or whatever, after he did, he sent me this track. So I turned the track on, I said, nah, that ain't BJ. So I sat Landon down, I said, Landon, listen to this. And we listened to it, and it was like killing. I mean, it was just.
It was Lord.
It was dope. I said, what happened? Did he smoke some weed or something? Black and mild. I mean, what did he do? Because it like changed everything. But I'm, you know, it has, production has a lot to do. And just because I've been doing it for so many years, not that I'm an expert, but it has a lot to do with how comfortable you are, the environment, how you feeling. Because if music is what you feel, you're trying to express that, then you got to be feeling good, you know. Yeah. And so, you know, I'm joking about the weed. No, we don't do that kind of stuff here at ABC. But he got comfortable and he got confident. And it was so funny. He asked me to give him a copy of an old CD that I did, the UMG music, U-Turn Music Group, way back in the day, like 91, 92. And that's what inspired him. So once he got that, it re-inspired him. So once he did that, he was bona fide. And when I came back over, I told him, man, this is great. And then he started dropping, you know, some real good music on it, on the project. And from there, it was, you know, it turned out to be what we have now.
Yeah, so, absolutely, yeah, man. Yeah. It's definitely what happened. I remember with that particular track that we're talking about that we sent was a track on the album called Lower Lord. And he was feeling himself so much, he videotaped himself nodding his head. And said, he said in the video, do I like it?
I don't know.
So that was cool, because it's so out of his character. When he did it, I knew it was going to be tight. So that was dope in that particular process. So, you know, I think because we had put the concept of doing music and allowing other people outside of our comfort zone to hear it so far out about mindset, that it was kind of hard initially to collaborate with people when it came to writing, when it came to production. We had grew so close as far as being just used to working with each other. We had learned each other's personalities and how we work. So when we wanted to bring in a PJ or Corey or Jermaine, or even Pastor for that matter, it was a bit of pressure for them. Because, I mean, you wanna be impressive. You wanna say, hey, if I'm working with you, I wanna come out and do it, you know, the best thing that I can do for you. I wanna give you the best service that I can offer you. Yeah. So that took a little minute before we were able to jump, or before he was able to jump that hurdle as well. And then I can be overbearing because I'm the musician who can never play an instrument, right? I can hear it, I can whistle it to you, but I can't do nothing. And half the time it sounds good, and the other half of the time, I don't know what I'm talking about. However, I'm the musician that can't play anything. So moving right along, let's open up a discussion about the actual songs. We all got a chance to hear the songs. We did a listening party with our church fellowship, which is Advent Believers Council, and some of us have copies of the songs. So one of the songs, I'll try to go in order if I can. One of the songs is titled Amos 3. Amos 3, what you want to talk about, kind of like how that came to be what it is, and you know, when you first produced it.
Yeah, when I first produced it, the second time.
Right. Exactly. Because it went through like three or four formations.
Yeah, it went through like three or four. Yeah.
Only talk about the after you got comfortable.
Right. Yes. After I got comfortable, we kept the original beat on there. And, you know, we asked PJ to come in and lay down a piano. So that's what you hear now is PJ on the piano. And, man, he just brought it to life, man. It made it like kind of opera feel. And it just made it real personal to Jay. Mm-hmm. So I mean, that's how we came up with it.
Right, right. And you know, and obviously Gerard Brooks is featured on that song as well. And I think it's significant to talk about, because we didn't have any reins on us in terms of how we were going to create. We actually tried to collaborate with other people. We tried to collaborate with my brother, He came down and visited, and it just didn't work out. Not because my brother's extremely talented, but it was something special about this project that we feel like God kept in control in terms of how we were going to produce it. So that was Amos 3. You guys will get, you know, what that song is about once you hear it. Then move right along to a song called Founders Day. I don't know if Brian even remembers this. When he first did the song, he was over my house helping me mount my TV. Mm-hmm. And he was like, man, I'm gonna let you hear something. I heard it. He was singing on the hook. He was singing on the hook. And I never told him this until later, but the hook was like 12 bars. And we tried to make it work for some reason, I don't know why. Make a long story short, that's where PJ came in. And PJ basically, you know, he became the main producer of the song. And Brian made sure everything's structured out right. But we featured Gerard Brooks on that as well. And what Brian originally wrote as the hook became,
I
guess. You might as well call it the third verse, I guess, so to speak, on the song called Founders Day. Do you remember anything about that session at all?
I remember hearing that. To me, it's like the signature sound in that song.
I remember it was the guitar in there, because you know PJ, he sat down, he's like, man, I can't
every time,
I don't know what to do.
Yeah. And then light it up,
and then he heard that signature guitar sandwich I think you came up with, and I just laid it down. I give you a props for that. I laid it down and he heard it. As soon as PJ heard it, he was like, oh yeah. So he sat down, he came up with the chords and all that, and it's just, I mean, it just turned into a great song. Yeah, and you did your thing on it.
Yeah, definitely. And Founders Day is actually, man, it's a great vibing song. I don't think anybody would have an issue agreeing with that. Then moving right along was the song Face of Stones. Now, Face of Stones went through a couple formations too. We had originally did a song with some other guys that we knew at one point that, you know, we no longer work with. So what happened was, we had a lot of collaborations with some people that we don't work with anymore. So we just went in and erased everything. When we came in Face of Stones, Brian was like, I don't know if we should get rid of this one. And then he had an idea, because at the time, Pastor G wasn't on it.
Right.
And he didn't tell me he had the idea. He was like, man, I got an idea for it. So he redid the music completely from top to bottom, added Pastor Lewis on there. Do you remember what series he was preaching on there at all?
He was preaching on persecution. I'm trying to think of the series. I can't remember the series.
Okay. You remember?
Oh, no. Okay. It's good, though.
Oh, yeah. So,
thank you.
This was like.
Thank you.
Face of Stones is probably about two and a half years old.
Yeah.
That song is very old. And one day I sent it to Pastor. I was really sending it to him to let him know, hey man, we got your vocals on here, I hope it's okay. That was really what my idea was, but he sent back the email and said, hey man, this is nice. And then that was it. And like, Pastor's like the master at the Frankenstein, like everything, facial expressions, conversation, you just never know what's behind what he's saying. So when he sent back, that was nice, I'm like, so can I use it or can I not? I didn't know what it was. Man, we wound up talking, he really did like it. But anyway, we wound up keeping it how it was. We tried to change it. We tried to add PJ to it. And Pastor was like, keep it the same. So he went back, because we had erased it, right?
Yeah, he erased it, started from scratch.
Yep, and we had an MP3 of the old version. So he literally had to go back and replay everything over again the same way. He added some pieces to it. Gerard Brooks is featured on that as well. But so that's Face of Stones as it relates to that. I know pretty much everybody, you knew the chorus when we were talking about it earlier.
Yeah.
Anything specific about that song sticks out to you that you would want to elaborate on per se?
I mean, just the words about it. I mean, nails in his hand, nails in his feet, you know.
No, that's Founders Day. Your song, like. That's nails in his head, nails in his feet, like a Baptist preacher. You know, a Baptist preacher, when he can't think of what he's trying to think of, he got to go to the cross. The cross is just going to encompass everything. You can't go wrong.
But it's the hook that he ever seen. It's the God of Hammer hook that he kept singing. So that's why I thought that was a perfect segue.
No!
You kept saying that. That's funny. My bad. But no, Face of Stones is going to be a great song. It is a great song.
And one thing, I think you ought to say something about Gerard Brooks.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think the first three or four songs we just talked about, Gerard is featured on them vocally.
Absolutely.
The way you guys work Gerard, Gerard need an award.
Yeah.
These dudes had Gerard drinking Red Bulls and sucking lozenges and everything. He was only here for one weekend. And I mean, these dudes bled him for everything he could do. Then he had to do a concert here
that Sunday
morning, the one y'all see on our Avid Believers page. Mm-hmm. He did that concert here and then had to leave the concert and go back in the studio. Y'all wore him out.
Yeah, man.
So I thought that was funny because he's a phenomenal singer.
Yep.
But y'all definitely worked him hard. Yeah.
We definitely did. He enjoyed every bit of it. Shout out to Gerard Brooks. That's family to ABC. I think we wanted to take a break, and he was like, "Nah, man, let's just keep going. Let's keep going."
Yeah, he showed us how to have fun. Well, showed me how to have fun because I've never been in a real studio environment. So,
yeah.
Man, he was cracking jokes.
He was
laughing, and he just made it real loose.
Yep, definitely did that. So moving right along. Song called Greater on the project that seems to be a fave amongst a lot of people. You want to share a little bit about it?
When I first heard the rawest version, I guess, of Greater, that's what made me fall in love with the project. I fell in love with that song. I told Jay, this is the best song. You're not going to be able to top this with nothing, just because of the flow of it. Mm-hmm. And because of the testimony that you were given, because you were given a humble man's testimony. Mm-hmm. And that, to me, that's what you don't hear, not just rap, but you don't really hear that with any artist.
Exactly.
Usually artists, and not knocking everybody or whatever, but a lot of artists prop themselves up to be in a certain place, and their vantage point is from being above the people. That's just kind of the trend. But this particular song, to me, scaled him way back and made him common among everyone that will hear that song. And so that's why I thought it was a great, great song. I fell in love with it. I think it's gonna touch a lot of people because they can see themselves in a song like that.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And I remember Pastor calling me one day and telling me about it. He was like, man, I let somebody hear it. And then they immediately got emotional over the fact of how raw and straight to the point that it was as it relates to the song Greater. So definitely looking forward to people being able to share in that as well. Then the next song will be a song called Let's Go to Made by Made In. Let's start off with that. That was another one that, it was very interesting in how it came together. You know, a lot of people don't know sometimes the role of an executive producer. So what Pastor Craig was able to do was, yay and nay certain songs. Certain songs he was like, man, whatever. And then certain songs he was like, that's something we really, really need. So a song called Made by Made In, Brian was going through a dry spell. He was like, man, I'm just not feeling creative, not motivated. And then he was like, I'll just send you what I got. And he sent four songs. Four beats, and Greater and Made by Made In came out of these four beats that he wasn't feeling for some reason.
So we know not to listen to him.
So the song originally had like this vibe to it, and it was reminiscent of something else. And I was inspired to write about it just because of everything that's going on in the world. And that's one thing about what we do. We're looking to still serve in that capacity, even though music is personal and creatively personal. We still look to serve others or outsiders with that particular source. So I wrote the song, we let Pastor hear it, and on one end, like for maybe about a month, Pastor was like, oh man, it's one of the coldest songs. Jermaine, I think it just means a lot what you're saying, da 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 da. Cool. And then one day he was like, I ain't really feeling this music no more. And what happened was I changed something. I took one of the notes or something off the hook.
Yep.
Which was interesting that you can hear something in a raw, like demo form, and still can tell when it's being created that whatever that was shouldn't have been taken out.
Yeah.
And he was just like, man, I was riding around in my car and one day and it just didn't sound the same. Make a long story short, that's where Levi Toukeen came in at,
yeah.
Which is from St. Louis.
Yeah, St. Louis, Levi, yeah. Yeah, he heard it and I asked him to, you know, not even listen to the, I didn't even give him, I told him not to listen to the original music. I told him just get it, take the music off, and just see what, you know, see what you feel. And Levi is phenomenal. So he heard it, and I mean, he put the music track to it and sent it back. And I mean, when we got it, I got it first. So I was sitting there with I had my wireless Beats on in my room. And I mean, I closed my eyes and I listened to it. And by the time I opened my eyes, everything around me was on the ground. I mean, I had literally just knocked everything down because it was just, I mean, the song, he did a phenomenal job with that track. And so it was really great. So I'm glad it turned out that way because the words are powerful. The way it counters the LGBT. I guess the highlight of that song for me, which brought me to tears, and you know, certain songs, Greater brought me to tears the first time I heard it, Made by Made In almost brings me to tears every time I hear it, because when we get to the end of that song, to hear those kids proclaiming who they are and speaking it, who they are made by, made in, they don't have a reason to pretend. I mean, that's just, you know, to hear kids say anything when it comes to singing and stuff is always touching, but to hear them making a proclamation and speaking it on themselves, not only is it touching to us, but it literally changes their whole trajectory for their own life when they say that.
Wow.
And so that's powerful for me, and I can just see kids all over repeating those words, people. And you know, sometimes we take it for granted that we're just singing a song, but you are literally speaking it over you, and it'll help you. So homosexual thoughts, lesbian thoughts, all these different things that may come, temptations or whatever, when you speak these things of who you are and what God made over yourself, it definitely changes your, you know, trajectory of your life. So that song's just powerful in a lot of ways.
That's right.
Yes, yeah. That's right. Yeah, and that's exactly the intention and the heart behind the song. So that was pretty cool. So let's go to another song, which is a song called Rap 4, which went through a couple of different lyrical formations. We immediately loved the track. At one point, I did want to try to like switch it up a little bit. Maybe I was overthinking.
He was overthinking.
But Pastor and Brian was like, dude, you crazy. We ain't doing nothing to it. And Rap 4 initially went harder than what it's going. A few names were mentioned, and you know, that's just not what and that's just not what we're about. It's not about necessarily the names all the time, especially not from this platform or doing music. We just want to inform people about the differences of what we do versus what people could be used to or what they may be influenced by. And so because we're not looking to be Christian or gospel beefing, like none of that, we took the names out just because the names were not the focus of the song.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's how that came about. Do anybody want to add to Rap 4?
Man, you spit on Rap 4.
Oh, okay.
Man, you being humble right now, but you killed Rap 4. That's why we liked it so much. That's why I liked it so much.
Yeah. And for months, he kept on saying, we got to get him, Jay. We got to get him. I'm like, dude. Yeah, you are giving me the wrong energy.
But you changed it. You changed it and made it whack.
I did. I changed the song. Yep.
And you changed it and didn't like it so much that you scratched it off the list of the songs.
Yeah, I did.
As if you were the executive producer. And I have to remind you that you weren't the executive producer. And we put the song back on.
Right.
So, but then you went back in and did it like you had done it originally, the very first time when you sent it to me. And I, you know, it's, the song is just great. And then we needed, I felt the hook, the this is what I rap for, if I see you weak, then I want to see you strong. I felt like that was a very ministering type of hook. Yeah. And it needed a smoother vocal, and that's where Corey came in and went in and laid his Luther on it. And some of y'all remember him from the wedding video, the infamous wedding video. That's all. I'm not gonna say anything else. Right. But yeah, he went in and laid that wonderful balladeer style. Yeah. Vocal on it, and I thought that just capped it off, and it was a done deal after that.
No, absolutely did that. So yeah, look out for that song, Rap For It. Let's bring it to a song called Willing to Die. Now, I remember when I brought the concept to Brian, it was when the a whole lot of persecution was taking place, or at least the persecution that we chose to commercialize here in the States, but we already know persecution happens consistently against the church abroad. And I really wanted not to necessarily do a song like an ode to them, so to speak, because I don't know persecution like that. I've never been in those scenarios, so I definitely didn't want to do a disservice to somebody trying to dedicate a song to that specific situation. But we wanted to do something in that realm. Of how we live here, specifically in the States of America. So he did one version of the beat that was his typical. Pastor used to always say that his production style is like his personality. And Brian is very even keel. If he's upset, you'll never know. If he's happy, you'll never know. You just never know. He's always the same. So a lot of his tracks initially come out very monotone, very, what his BPMs is, 86, 88, same like always the same BPM. And I was about to scratch that one off. And he was like, dude, you crazy. And after Pastor sent them his songs, he redid the beat completely. And we had even reached out to some people to collab on that song too, just because we were trying to give it some other life. And we wound up not going that route. He redid the beat. I rewrote to it, which he fought me on, because he was like, dude, there's no way you could
top this.
I went and I did two new verses with a completely different mindset, and he was like, wow, cool. Redid the hook, and then one of the verses from the first creation of it, we used for the intro of Willing to Die, which kind of set the tone, which we've been discussing is now going to be probably most likely the intro to the entire album, which is the Willing to Die intro. So that's you wanted to.
Yeah, I mean, Willing to Die is a song nobody's talking about. Nobody, I've never heard anybody talk about a song like that. Like, you know, especially overseas, what they're going through, they're being killed for being Christians. Mm. And, you know, we're here and we take it for granted. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, they have to hide out and have church and fellowship with believers, read the Bible, and we're over here and we take it for granted. Nobody, no Christian rapper, nobody's talking about that. And I kind of took it personal. You know, when you read stuff online, like Christians are dying, you see men, their families are being killed in front of them for being believers and stuff like that. Like, I mean, it touches you. Like, man, how, you know, we scream we Christians and stuff like that, but are we really willing to die for what we believe in? I mean, that's powerful for me. So that, I mean, when I got in the studio, it was just, man, you gotta make it loud. You gotta make it, you know, make it hit. Mm-hmm. And then when Gerard came in there, he did his, you know, what he do to it. He do his thing on it. I mean, it just brought it to life, man. It just made it just like a war cry, almost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely. So, yeah, I mean, a great song. Another highlight, or I would say people favorite, would be Through the Fire.
Oh yeah.
We'll let PJ, if you remember. No.
Let's see.
Right. Through the Fire, but is it more so the production of it? Is it the lyrics? Or what is it about Through the Fire that you really like?
The whole, the production. I was telling Jay earlier, just creatively, what he did with the drums on there, I love it. But then hearing the lyrics and the particular account in the Bible you're highlighting with the three Hebrew boys, it's just, you know, mm-hmm. the way that you kind of just put it together lyrically. Mm-hmm. And I just love it, man. It's a really encouraging song, yeah. Like, oh, for believers. So I think that's kind of what stood out for me. Mm-hmm. It's like reminding you, no matter persecutions, trials, what we face, mm-hmm. we're going to make it through the fire with Christ.
Right. Amen.
Don't bow. Don't give up. Don't give in. So, yeah, I really like that one.
Cool. Cool. Well, I appreciate that, man. Like, I think Through the Fire came and another batch of beats that Brian wasn't feeling.
Let me tell you about it. He says, I sent him beats that I'm going to, I don't know what, I mean, he's just a different rapper. I don't know what he's feeling. I don't know where his head is at the time. So when I send him stuff, I'm trying to be creative and I don't know if he's going to like it. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, the stuff that I don't like, he likes it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's true. That's actually very true. And we do like, I mean, you know, people get a chance to experience the different assortment of production styles that's on the project. But Through the Fire was originally before, it's now with live drums, with Jermaine on there, Brother Jermaine on there. But when it hit me, I remember I sent the beat to you. I sent the beat to Pastor, but Pastor was like, Brian didn't do this. I was like, he did. Because Brian don't do bass lines for some reason. Well, he, at the time, it wasn't a part of his flavor or his repertoire production wise. And they had a bass line on it. So I was even shocked by, like, this dude put a bass line on there. So definitely, and then Gerard came and started preaching at the end of it like it was his own song, so it kind of took it to a whole nother level.
But to me, the guitar made the song.
Yeah.
The guitar, all the guitar tracks on it, the doubled up tracks, just everything that Corey did was genius.
Yeah.
Even the underlying, you know, grunge kind of rhythm that you did. I mean, dude.
There's some blues riffs in there too.
At
first I was like, man, why did he do that? But it came out.
Though. Yeah, that did it. And then Carla set it off.
Yeah.
Carla Williams, my sister, she did a great job as well. She that song is just good.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
Good cut.
So moving right along to Lord is also another song that's probably about 2.5-3 years old that went through about 3 or 4 different formations as well. You know, I'll speak to that in terms of the message lyrically, how I delivered it on there was something that was also near and dear. At one point, I wanted it to be an intro type song for a project if ever wants to come to fruition. And Lord, you know, I thought about the opposite side of the scripture that's found in Matthew when it talks about, Lord, did we not prophesy? Did we not perform all these things and do all these things in your name, right? Mm-hmm. And Jesus responded to them by saying, depart from me. I never knew you, you workers of iniquity. I was like, think about it, right? Everybody feel like they're, and if we call ourselves Christians, we feel like we're doing it all for God, right?
Yeah.
Now imagine coming to that point and Jesus telling you, nah, I don't know you.
Right, yeah, right.
So my thing was, let's repent now, change that now, whatever could possibly get us that response from our Savior, let's change that now. So I flipped the Lord to the crying out, not in boastfulness, like, I did all of this for you, but more like, deal with me now so that when I finally see you, you don't have to respond to me that way.
Right.
So that's what the song was about in terms of why we titled it Lord. And I think that it deals with everything as it relates to the church and abroad.
That's the live band kind of feel, which, you know, after they had brought me several songs, I just felt like we needed the band on some of the songs. I wanted a musical, I mean, not I want, I'm saying like I was looking for, I don't mean it like that, but I just felt like with the talent we have here in these guys, the band is, you know, a big part of what we do here at ABC. And we play together every week. And so I just felt like the album, if you did that, it would give it a flavor that you just can't buy hardly anymore.
Amen.
And I was explaining to someone today about the 90s feel, because a lot of people are going to try to explain the sound of this album by dating it. And the reason they're going to date it is because the day of this kind of music is gone.
Amen.
So the only way you can describe live band playing with a rapper and all this is to date it back, because now it's non-existent. everything is synthesized. And so people are going to hear this album and be like, man, it's kind of like a 90s feel to it. Well, right. No, it don't have a 90s feel to it. It's just in the 90s was the last time people played instruments on an album like this. So, and I felt that that was important because we're musicians that play, and these guys could bring a flavor to it that you couldn't get by just synthesizing the project in the studio. And so we did the live band, brought Chuck Smith in on bass, and it just, to me, it gave it a life to where, I mean, the lyrics are great, don't get me wrong. He really preached. You turn the lyrics off and vibe to that. Just sure give me a 15-minute version, and I'm just going to ride around and just listen to it.
Corey added the hook.
Yeah, Corey added the hook on it with the guitar and just soloed at the end. I mean, it's just a song with just crazy vibe to it me.
Definitely. So look forward to that. And I may be missing a song or two, but we're going to end this particular segment before we completely wrap up with a song called Mountaintop. So a little bit of history behind Mountaintop. Actually, it was one of the first songs in its original form that Brian actually mixed. And it was pretty decent. But when he did it, I think I got it at like 6 o'clock in the morning, and I was doing my thing with the Lord or whatever. And I listened to it in some headphones. I don't know if you remember this, but it brought me to tears, and I called you.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, this song just made me cry. He was like, why? I was like, because we don't see this modeled, in the music industry or in the entertainment field, let alone hardly in the body of Christ, when it comes to what we see being broadcasted. And that is exactly what our Savior did, what Jesus did. When he finished the 40 days, he, as in Jesus Christ, finished the fasting of the 40 days and 40 nights, and he was tempted by the devil on the top of the mountain, and was offered all these kingdoms of the world by the devil. Jesus, right, said no.
Right.
No.
No.
And we don't see that model. And so that's what Mountaintop is talking about. Telling the world, no, I don't need a broader audience. I don't need a higher stage. I don't need
a mountain.
I don't need a mountain, right?
That's right.
I don't need to be in the higher rankings of a specific category in the area of the world in order for God to show himself strong. He can do that however he chooses to, with whomever he chooses to do it with, whenever he wants to.
That's right.
And so that Mountaintop song was used for Pride of Life originally, and then we reproduced it. Andrea Williams, pastor's sister, came through, blessed the microphone. She sung on the hook, and it took on another life of its own.
Yeah.
Chuck played bass.
Actually, that's the ABC band.
That's the ABC band.
That's another ABC song band. Another thing that's different about it from Lord, we kept some. We hit some digital drums in there. Mountaintop was done in its entirety production-wise right here on the stage that we're actually sitting on. Mm-hmm. So everything was played live from top to bottom.
Yeah.
No cutting, no pasting, no none of that. So I thought that was a special song to highlight as well. So bring this all to a close. You know, we're different. It won't be hard to notice that. It won't be hard to point out that we do everything differently. The way we produce, the way we write, the way we handle putting this project together, how we're putting it out, it coming out through EX Ministries is one facet of it, but the testimony behind these guys who are as equally talented as anybody else could easily go the industry route, could easily have one foot in, one foot out as it relates to how they decided to conduct themselves with their talents. But nobody is touring on the weekend or during the week. Nobody's playing on clubs Friday, Saturday night. Nobody has their own separate group on the side that they're trying to make it big with. Nobody's doing anything other than serving within the local church community. And I thought that that was a great testament to how the body of Christ should be producing our own music.
Yeah,
that's right. You know,
that's right.
We don't need to share anybody. We certainly don't need to borrow anybody. And we certainly don't need to go to the world for affirmation.
Yes, sir.
As long as we ground ourselves right here in the kingdom of God, and whatever he decides to do with that, he'll do it. So, you know, no, we don't support Christian hip-hop or holy hip-hop or the gospel music industry at all. And it's not to to call ourselves better or anything like that. It's simply just to set the difference between the sacred and the profane.
Yeah.
What the Bible actually says to do. The reason why we're so comfortable is because, you know, we don't see the industry mirrored in scripture. So the way to keep ourselves in check, the way to keep ourselves in line, is to do our best to mirror scripture when it comes to every facet of life, including the arts, including our creativity. So I want you fellas to help me out. I mean, I can't speak for you. So we'll start with Brother Corey in terms of, you know, how do you feel or can you add to, you know, as far as our process and how we did it?
The process to me, I guess it was real like organic, I guess, you know, and coming from music, like my whole background, because me and Jay met in Detroit. We've known each other maybe 7 years, and we both were in it, but I think the connector was really EX Ministries, and it was just the message behind it. And it changed for me when I got married, started having kids, and everybody that I seen played, they compromised. There's no security, it was unstable, you know, no benefits to it, just compromise. And I didn't want to fall into that. So I stopped playing. Ended up coming down here, connecting with Pastor and, you know, and the heroes, as we call the men here at ABC. And that was my focus. My focus was to just be a better husband, be a better father. And then the music was just an addition to it. But I seen, like, really the hand of God move more in my life by just creation role, is what we call it. So it was easy to kind of turn it away because it's just smoke and mirrors, you know, so... Hmm.
Yep.
It's not real. It's just it's an ability for one. You have a lot of guys that I've seen, they mask it, say, you know, that's your gift, you need to play and, you know, and utilize it for this, but it's not. It's just an ability. It's an expression. But I guess in this album, because I said it before, I didn't like rap at first.
Mm-hmm.
So what connected me to Jay was just our common ground and just having a heart to, you know, just to please God. And so when we came down here and we kind of began to walk that path and just sit down, first thing I told Pastor, I said, I just want to submit to the word, the ministry, and just serve. And so I guess in this album, what you're hearing is just the growth in all of us. And the music is just, it just came with it. So it's no way I can really say how it came about, because even some of the songs, I don't remember. I know we just, he was like, hey, Corey, come and play. Came and played. Some music we used, some we didn't. So I'm just happy it turned out the way it did. But as far as, you know, I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just your perspective on it as it relates to, you know, how we do it and what our process is. I recall, you finished? All right, moving right along with Brian. I recall Brian letting me know that he had a partner at one point, and that's all they used to do. He told me, he's like, dude, I used to get off of work, you know, wife and kids at home. I used to be like, man, whatever, I'm about to go over to my boy house and do some records or whatever. And they had their goals or whatever, but it was a turning point. I don't know if you want to elaborate on that or whatever.
Yeah, the turning point was, you know, me hearing the truth behind hip hop and just getting saved, you know.
Amen.
Accepting God and, you know, putting him forth in my life. And what I realized in that, even, you know, after being saved and accepting God, coming to him, my partner, trying to reach him, he wouldn't accept it. And once that happened, it was just like we had nothing else in common but music.
Amen.
And after that, it was just over with. And then when we met Jay, I know, before we even got in the studio, we sat there and had that conversation because we had similar stories, and it was just like, man, you know, we need to get to know each other first because we don't want that to happen where we just in the studio all the time. We don't know nothing about each other. Mm-hmm. We never, you know, talk, never, you know, never hang out or nothing like that. And then once the music stops, we don't know what to say to each other. Right. We ain't cool anymore. So, I mean, that's one thing that we definitely stress with each other, just, you know, just to get to know each other, our families hang out. You know, iron sharpens iron. So there's stuff I learned from him, stuff he learned from me, just with the whole message, the creation role message was a big deal for me.
Amen.
Definitely a big thing for me, just taking care of my family, providing for them. And I know a lot of musicians that's still crazy. You know, they can't find a job. They can't hold a job, for one, and most importantly, they don't know how to submit to authority.
Right. Yeah,
that's
right.
The most important thing.
Yeah.
So, you know, in order for you to have a family and to, you know, have a job, you have to submit to authority and you have to just be disciplined enough.
Mm-hmm. And you got that coaching background, you know, you was bumping too in that Oregon.
Yeah.
So you've been treated like the musician, how the church puts musicians on platform. So I think that's big to your testimony too.
Definitely.
To walk away from that, to focus on the family.
Walk away from money.
Yep. Yes, amen.
That's
yep. So move right along to Brother PJ. His story, he had a few phone calls, if I recall, that were, you know, he could have made some serious money, right, when it came to being a church musician. He comes from that life or whatever. So, you know, you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
Man, so just going off of what my brother said here, this situation, this whole project is unique. All of us pretty much have a similar story in that we kind of left music alone for a while. Mm-hmm. And I think that's very important for anybody that's maybe looking at, you know, what Jay is doing or what we did. I think one of the biggest things is denying yourself, your ability, your Amen. Talent. Because a lot of times, like what Brian was saying, we can get the big head and get prideful because, you know, a lot of times musicians, we're put up higher, held up higher amongst the congregation. Mm-hmm. Man, and I know for me personally, God took me through a point where He brought me way down low. I left music alone for a while, and I had to learn how to be a man, how to learn how to work a job, take care of my wife and my kids.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big part of it, is this process, all of us kind of went through the whole detoxing from the music is my life thing. The music is my main focus.
Yeah.
And so the creation role message for me, that really brought my focus, I guess, right with what we're doing here. And the music, like Corey was saying, it's just side. Being here at the church and just being with your brothers, the music is just an addition. The word is the main thing. And so I just think that's important to keep that in perspective as a musician.
Amen. Amen, man. Appreciate you sharing that. You know, because it's not easy, especially when you know, because you got married fairly young, right, with kids, and it's not easy to decide to, I guess, when you know money is being offered to you for something that comes as easy as music comes to you, it's not easy being able to say, hey, you know what? I think I'm gonna just try what the way people consider to be the hard way, which is just by faith, right? Which is believers is what we're called to live by anyway. And also, which is what scripture says is impossible to please God without it. So commend you on that. So moving along to Brother Jay's similar story, did a lot of music. You went on some tours or had traveled a little bit? No, that's not what happened.
Well,
but in Utah.
Well, just, you know, same as all my brothers here. Grew up playing in church. Been playing drums basically since I was 8 years old. You know, and just growing up, I just thought that music was everything, you know. But beginning to hear, you know, Pastor G message on creation roles and, you know, how work a job, work a 9-to-5, you know, be satisfied in that role. Mm-hmm. That should be the end game, you know, our family, you know. So music isn't everything, you know. I used to get paid money to play, stuff like that, but at the end of the day, it don't mean nothing. You know, just as long as my family is satisfied on, you know, me taking care of them and raising them up, training up my children in the fear of the Lord, you know. That's my ultimate goal. You know, that's pretty much it.
Amen. Yeah, great, man. And I just thought it was important for us to share our own individual thoughts on this. It's not contrived. This wasn't pre-planned. We didn't know each other like LeBron and D-Wade and all of them did. We didn't conspire to come together and form this transformer team to have this testimony. This is 100% God's working. And when it's God, nobody can deny it. When it's God, we're not looking for any outside people to affirm what we're doing. And And that's what feels, I guess, so organic, like Brother Corey was saying about the entire process and the manner. And so we didn't conduct ourselves like our former selves as it relates to, you know, collaborating musically, collaborating lyrically. And people know what those standards are when it comes to coming together. We didn't talk about splits. We didn't talk about royalties. We didn't talk about any. We have no idea what's happening when this record comes out. No idea. We don't think about it. Have we had any discussions about it?
No.
I haven't. Nobody's called. Nobody. We don't care. And that's what we see God using often when the person that's being set up to be used doesn't have any side influences or any side motives to do anything different with it. And we just don't. We really don't care. So I want to appreciate you guys again on camera for being a part of it, for being so humble, for being so submissive with your high caliber talents. It's not like we got some chumps up here. I mean, these guys are A1, period. And Pastor testifies about it all the time, morning service and Sunday morning service, as it relates to these guys can go get checks. Nobody's holding their hands. They're not arrested here. We're not in prison. It's not a cult. This is something
that's right.
That's manifested through a servant of our pastor, received the word, gave it to us, but also models it.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yep. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So the examples that we're trying to be is already set before us. And man, I just believe God is gonna do whatever he wants to do with it, and I'm still excited about it. So Pastor G, you know, we're sons of EX Ministries, right?
Yeah.
You know, you God dealt with you in many various ways. You've talked about to the public on many different occasions. You submitted to what your call was as it relates to that message of being the truth behind hip hop. And we're now on its 10th installment. And it deals a lot with fatherlessness.
Yeah.
And I hopefully we got a few minutes. In some shape, form, or fashion, we've all dealt with it, right? Not having that consistent male figure, not all of us, but I'm speaking abroad. We deal with that, not having that affirmation, not having the fortitude displayed or not having the proper training coming up to be the proper godly husbands and fathers that we need to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so for you to submit to that teaching yourself, to be corrected yourself, to study it and to administer it the way you do, with much sacrifice, much diligence, you know, if you can close us out with just giving a little of that. So it's other musicians out there. There's other people who want to do music.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was having a conversation with Chuck Smith. Chuck is probably, like I said, who played bass on this project. He's one of the greatest bass players ever. Chuck is about to retire from his job. He's been working there for 30 years. Greatest musician, greatest bass player I think I've ever heard. This guy has, you know, he's sought after by all musicians everywhere. They make a bass specially for him. The dude is just great. But this guy has been consistent with working a job. And I talked to him and I was like, you know, Chuck, man, you know, you're doing something that you don't see much. And he said, man, I got a family. I need benefits. He's like, my daughter's going to college. My kid's going to school. He's like, dude, what am I gonna do with something that's not gonna give me retirement benefits and all these kind of things? And when you put that in perspective, you realize that a lot of times these things aren't being preached because of the dire need of a church to have people play, because a church needs the music so bad. They're not sitting the guys down and talking to them about taking care of your family after music, or, you know, how do you retire from playing music at a church or playing for a church? How do you invest? How do you get a 401? Well, most of those things aren't even associated with it. Playing music is for the moment, and you're good for that moment. And then when things change, the younger guy that will play for half of what you were charging,
right,
is better than you now. And so once he comes in, that'll play for half of what you charge. You old school. He's new school, and he plays for half because he's got all day to sit there, braid his hair, and put his earrings in. He don't have to go nowhere and do nothing else while you got a family you trying to take care of. So it's just like, okay, now you out, and let's bring the young talent in. And that's what a lot of musicians are faced with now, because this wasn't thought of, or they didn't think of this, or these things happening. And so when each one of these guys, God bless me to meet each one of these guys, I Skype with some of them I met once they got here, whatever the case, the first thing I let them know was, hey man, you know, I basically want to fall in love with you. And that, no homo. But I don't want to love what you can do.
Yes, right. That's right.
I don't want to love your ability, bro.
Yeah.
You know, I don't. We did ABC for six months with no music at all. Mm-hmm. We built this church without music. So, bro, we can go back to that. I want to love you guys. I want to know you. I want you to be successful as a father, as a husband, as an example to your boys, to your girls, that kind of thing, because those are the things that give us affirmation as men. But a lot of times when we don't have a father to model that, or our father didn't model it, we begin to look to outsource it. And this is all in my Pop Life DVD, but we look to outsource these things. And music is one of the greatest ways to outsource it, because you can get validated by people's opinion of what you're able to do, even though they don't know you. And so it never challenges your character, it never challenges your personal life, it never challenges the decisions you make. It's just superficial. But when it comes to pleasing your family, when it comes to pleasing your wife, when it comes to trying to live right, which we all are, those are the things that affirm us to the point to where we don't need external praise. And so when we focus on that, you can go play for the fun of it, because the job, your wife being proud of you for coming home with sweat on you, with dirt on you, your children running in and saying, hey, daddy, glad to see you come home. Those things feel better than any superficial praise you can get because you wrote a song.
Wow. Right, sir.
And so that's what these guys are. I'm telling you what I did personally when I took my hiatus from music. And I think it's important that every musician understands that. Dude, what you can do may be good for the moment, but who you are is what's important. And so that's kind of what we're trying to, you know, just illustrate here with this process.
Amen. 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 So we're going to bring it to a close, man. Thank you guys for tuning in. Christian Rap will be available soon, or either it is available now. Man, thank you, Pastor. I gave Pastor a little bit of this vision as it relates to my heart was, because we want to encourage other people who are talented to seek out a different way. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that. We appreciate that, man. And God bless.
Yeah.